The ideal wife, Sita. Shri Ram is to be anointed as a Yuvraj tomorrow, the maids told Janaki. She was elated. Vasishtha Muni was the Kulacharya. He had come personally to tell her what she was expected to observe by way of rites, rituals, fasting and prayers. She was asked to be ready early next morning. The dawn of the ceremonial day arrived, but no messenger came to invite her for the function. The wait seemed long, but it ended with the announcement of Sri Ram's arrival. Sri Ram came, but he appeared rather brooding and serious. Sri Ram said, "Janaki, our respected Pitashri has pronounced two commands. The first is that Bharat to be anointed as a crown prince instead of me. And secondly, I have to go to the forest for 14 years. I shall undertake this journey today itself." Sita did not show any slightest trace of sadness or shock. She calmly replied, "Oh, so you have made a decision. It must have been after due thought. But how did all this happen, and that too so suddenly?" Sri Ram briefly narrated the entire sequence of events that had just taken place. He then asked her consent for his departure. Janaki said, "The question of my consent for your proceeding into exile does not arise. It would have been needed if I were to stay back, but I am not. I am coming with you. Wherever Ram, Sita goes with him." Ram tried to dissuade her, saying, "Sita, your delicate body will not be able to cope with the harsh and tough forest life. No material comfort will be available to you in the jungles. You must stay back and look after the king and our mother queens. Hence, you should stay back." Sita, however, was not going to listen to any argument of her husband. She firmly replied, "My body will not be affected by the rigors of nature. I can face any discomfort with you at my side. Do you imagine for even a moment that I can be happy without you?" Ram tried to persuade her to stay back. He reminded her about her duties towards in-laws, duty of being the eldest daughter-in-law, wife of the eldest prince, etc. Once again, he also elaborated the hardships. "But Lord, my duty as your wife surpasses all other roles of a daughter, daughter-in-law, princess, etc. My duty as a wife is supreme for me. I will not stay back. Please do not condemn me to death like this." Sita shed tears while saying this. Janaki's arguments were flawless. Her determination was unwavering. Sri Ram had to consent to her accompanying him. When she wanted to don the bark of the tree, Maharshi Vasishtha said, "The conditions of stay in forest do not apply to Janaki. She can continue wearing royal clothes and ornaments." Sita respectfully replied, "Gurudev, your order is a divine command for me, but you must forgive. I am determined to live and eat as my husband. I will be most pleased if I can follow my husband." Sita lived very happily in the forest. She planted a small garden with creepers and flower beds, creating a heavenly atmosphere. She loved birds and animals and affectionately looked after them. Sri Ram and Lakshman, meanwhile, continuously eliminated the Rakshasas from their domain. In the process, Shurpankha was disfigured. This provoked Ravan to abduct Sita. While she was being carried away by air, she tore a part of a sari and tied some of her ornaments and threw them down. Sita's ornaments landed on Rishamukh mountains, where the Vanars happened to see it. When Sri Ram came searching for her, these ornaments were of immense help in providing him a definite direction and clue regarding her whereabouts. Ravan kept Sita captive in the Ashokvan. He asked her to accept him, sometimes imploring her and threatening her at other times. But Sita minced no words in condemning him and dismissing his entreaties and threats. The day Hanuman reached Lanka in search of her, Ravan visited Ashokvan in the early hours of the morning, dressed in fine robes and accompanied by his many wives. His message to Sita was, "Consent to be my wife, Sita. Look at my wealth, golden Lanka, powerful and unconquerable. Accept me as a lord and rule over Lanka as her empress." But Janaki's reply to the Rakshasa king was according to her pious and lofty character. "O lord of Lanka, you have completely forsaken Dharma. Do not try to impress me with your wealth and power. Remember, I am Raja Janak's daughter and Maharaj Dashrath's daughter-in-law. I am the consort of Lord Ram, who is my very life. I cannot even dream of being separate from him, even for a second. My father-in-law Maharaj Dashrath had defeated the Asuras while helping the gods long ago. Have you forgotten that? Ram is the eldest son of Maharaj Dashrath, and his power and valor have no parallel in the three worlds. You have behaved like a thief by abducting me. You cannot understand the greatness of a person who sacrifices an entire kingdom and accepts the torturous forest life to fulfill his father's promise. Sri Ram will never take my abduction lying down. So be wise, restore me to him and make peace with him." Ravan was angry at Sita's reply. He said in a threatening voice, "Sita, I give you 2 months more time. If you do not agree to become my wife, then I will cut your delicate body into pieces and have you for my food." Ravan went back to his palace after issuing this dire threat to Sita. Hanuman was watching the whole drama hidden in a treetop nearby. When the opportunity presented itself, he came down. He introduced himself to Sita and spoke to her, giving her Sri Ram's message as well as hope. Sita's joy knew no bounds. She got a fresh lease of confidence. Later, Sri Ram and Lakshman arrived in Lanka with a huge Vanar army, defeated and killed Ravan in war, and rescued Sita. Sita returned to Ayodhya with Ram. He was crowned king and Sita became the empress. Later, Sita was pregnant. She then felt like moving in open places, breezy areas. One evening, Lakshman came to her palace. He told her to be ready the next day. They had to leave for the banks of the Ganga early in the morning. When Lakshman arrived, Sita was ready. She boarded the golden royal chariot. It took more or less the same route which they had taken 14 years back. Old memories surfaced. They crossed the river Ganga. It was evening when they reached Rishi Valmiki's ashram. The chariot halted. Lakshman requested Sita to sit under a tree. With folded hands and tears in his eyes, he stood before her. Sobbing, Lakshman somehow mustered courage to tell her the truth. With a voice laden with emotion, he said, "You are aware that the welfare of the people is uppermost in Sri Ram's mind. For this purpose, even one's own happiness or that of our nearest and dearest may have to be sacrificed. In Lanka, you were made to undergo the ordeal by fire. It isn't that Sri Ram doubted your purity. He is absolutely certain of your chastity in his mind. He is also aware of the hurt and agony this will cause you. And yet, he has made a decision to convince the people so that they may not raise a finger of doubt. And now, here I am to carry out one of the most painful orders. Janaki, despite your purity and chastity, like the Ganga, a certain washerman has made a nasty comment, casting aspersions about your character. Sri Ram decided to banish you upon hearing this. You know him intimately. He will not want an endorsement free of any blemish from the people. You must forgive him." Sita's grief knew no bounds. Where should I go? Where can I go? Lakshmana cursed himself at his helplessness. Unable to bear his own sorrow, he started driving his chariot away. Sita was left all alone in the forest. After Sita recovered, she consoled herself saying, "Probably there was no other choice, and that is why, my dearest, you must have made this decision. I am damn sure about it. Your duty must come first. We shall always reside in each other's heart and soul." Controlling herself, Sita reached Maharshi Valmiki's ashram and said, "My husband is wedded to people's welfare. I have decided to reside in the forest to help him fulfill his duties unhindered. But I am also carrying the heir to the Raghu dynasty. Please do accept me as a daughter and let me have this ashram as my own parental home." Maharshi Valmiki was also a seer. He blessed her by placing his hand over her head and led her inside the ashram.